Very warm welcome to Rihant Online Academy, and here it is a part 9 for UGC NET December 2019's Computer Science Paper 2, right? And in previous 8 parts we have discussed the first 40 questions, and the link for the first 8 parts are given in the description section, so you can watch them too and get the solutions, right? And the question number 41 is, consider the game tree given below, where the circle marks and rectangle marks are basically representing minimum and maximum respectively. Means this circle marks is representing minimum and this rectangle mark is representing maximum. The value of the root node of the game tree is, we need to find the value of that root node, right? So basically this circle, it is representing minimum, it is representing minimum, and these rectangles are representing maximum value, right? So if we go through the game tree, then here 17 and 19, and we need to put it minimum here because circle is representing minimum, so here 17 will come. Similarly here only one element is there, so no problem. Here minimum 111, and here nothing is there. Then here 15 is there, here 14 is there, and nothing, right? Now I need to choose maximum from 17 and 16 here, right? So maximum is 17 here and triple one, so maximum is only triple one, and maximum among between 15 and 14 is 15, and here nothing is there. Then again I need to choose minimum between 17 and triple one, so minimum is 17 and again minimum is 15, and again if I will go, then maximum among maximum between 17 and 15 is 17. So the value of root node of the game tree is 17. So I hope you got the concept. So basically it is the binary tree concept which they have made using a simple game tree. You just need to apply your concepts and you can get the correct answer, right? So this was the question which was asked in the UGC NET paper 2 in December 2019. So guys, I am just requesting you to guys please like the video, subscribe the YouTube channel and press the bell icon button so that at least we get response from you, so we can try for further more questions, and we can also try to make all previous years questions solutions for you, right? So guys, just show your response by liking the video, commenting, by interacting with us as much as possible, by subscribing the YouTube channel and press the bell icon button so that we can get at least response from you. The next question here is, identify the circumstances under which preemptive CPU scheduling is used. So preemptive CPU scheduling should be used, right? So for that you can also watch CPU scheduling chart. In CPU scheduling chart you will get to know better concept there, and if you really want to learn from our side, then please comment that we want to learn CPU scheduling so that we can make a brief lecture on that as well, right? So a process switches from running state to ready state. So if a process is switching from running to ready state, right, running to ready state, then here we need preemptive scheduling, because if a process is there which is too long running but not going to the ready state, right, then okay, running and ready is there. So suppose ready is there, okay, no problem. Okay, a process switches from running state to ready state. Okay, so suppose a process is running and it need to go into the ready state, and suppose here is executed completely, and suppose here is a waiting state. Okay, so from running to ready I can go to waiting, and from waiting to I can go to ready, means I need to follow this path, and from ready to running I can need to follow this path, right? So a process switches from running state to ready state, it needs preemptive CPU scheduling. A process switches from waiting state to ready state, from waiting state to ready state, it also needed CPU preemptive CPU scheduling. A process completes its execution. Suppose if process is completed, already completed its execution, no need of preemptive CPU scheduling here. And a process switches from ready to waiting. Ready to waiting. So ready to waiting is like we need to go to ready to run and run to waiting. So it also does not need preemptive CPU scheduling, right? So we only need 1 and 2. Option A is the correct answer, because suppose the process is too long waiting in the running state and want to again go to the ready state, right? then it needs preemptive unless deadlock may occur or a process switches from waiting to ready state. It may need preemptive because if a process is there that suppose that process is waiting too long, then that also need to be preemptive scheduling there, right? So guys, this concept you may clear by watching the CPU scheduling chart concept. And if you really want to learn that, then please comment so that we can go for that, right? Because it will need a brief knowledge of that. And we are ready to commence that lecture as well, but it completely depends on your response. Here, you can at least go for option A. The next question is, consider the following grammars. Four grammars are given to us, G1, G2, G3 and G4. G1 is like that, G2 is like that, G3 and G4, right? And we need to find which are equivalent. So option A is G1 and G3 are equivalent. G1 and G3, you can directly say they are not equivalent by just seeing the grammar. Because here only A can be possible, but here double A is possible, right? So only A can't be possible with G1. So it's false. G2 and G3 are equivalent. G2 and G3. You can directly say that they are not equivalent because it can generate empty language as well. It can generate empty language as well, but G3 can't generate empty language. So they are also not equal. G2 and G4, yeah, they might be equal, but let's see next option. G3 and G4, so G3 and G4, yeah, it's again not equivalent because G3 can't generate empty language, but G4 can generate empty language. So we have cancelled three options. We have cancelled A, B and D because they are 100% not surely possible. So we are only left with G2 and G4. So it is 100% correct answer, right? And you can also go for by drawing their trees and you can match them, right? But here C is the correct answer. The next question is, consider the following model. So basically guys, UGCNET their perspective on the theoretical question as well, right? So there are some questions like this that you just need to learn the theoretical concept, means you just need to read theory, no logic is there, you just need knowledge, right? So here question is, consider the following model. M1 is Mamdani model, M2 is Takagi Sueno Kang model, and M3 is Costco's ADT model. And the question is, which of the following option contains example of additive rule model? Which of the following option contains examples of additive rule model? So we just need to know the concept. Costco's additive model is there, so M3 is the correct answer. So A is not, M3 should be there, M3 should be there, right? So M2 and M3 is the right answer. Takagi Sueno Kang model and Costco's additive model. So option B is the right answer, right? You just need to have knowledge about that, right? No need to explain here because theoretical question, completely theoretical question. The next one is, which of the following inter-cost communication model is used to exchange messages among cooperative processes? So shared memory model is there, which is used to inter-cost communication model to exchange messages among cooperative processes, and message passing model. So option C is the correct answer. Shared memory and message passing model. So guys, these are the some of the theoretical questions, and for that you just need to read the theoretical books or the conceptual things so that we can solve such kind of questions there, because UGCNET basically only 10 to 15% theoretical 10 to only 15% numerical questions are there, and 10 to 15% some logical questions which we have we can generate some logic there, and the remaining 10 to 15% questions be like some kind of thinking questions by which you can use your aptitude and you can solve that, and the remaining one is completely based on your knowledge. Means you just need to have knowledge of the topic, and on the basis of that knowledge you can either cancel the several options or you can get the right answer, right? So you just need to have knowledge of that theoretical concept there. Means at least 30 to 40 questions are like numerical and aptitude, then remaining 60% are theoretical based question they are. So it is the advantage of solving previous year's questions that at least you get the knowledge that what kind of questions they are asking, and many times they are repeat the same questions as well. We have already seen in our some previous questions in several parts, it's right that directly they are asking repeatedly questions. So this is the advantage of the solving previous year questions, that if 5 to 10 questions are also repeated, now you can get advantage of 20 marks there if you have solved previous year questions. So guys, I hope you will watch the previous 8 parts as well and are ready to watch the upcoming parts as well. So please do subscribe to our YouTube channel, press the bell icon button, and comment us if you have any kind of queries or doubts or suggestions, and have a very, very nice day, guys. Thank you so much. Jai Hind, Jai Bharat.